getting a lung function test can be performed at multiple different areas. Obviously, you can get them performed at a GP's practice, at a specialist clinic that's outside of a hospital, or there's a hospital-based clinic. Now, under the current COVID recommendations, it may be a little bit tricky to get, or some GPs may not be offering spirometry. If that's the case, then they may be able to refer you on to a specialised respiratory clinic, and you may be able to perform them there. Regarding the limitations during the COVID pandemic, as some GP practices may not be providing spirometry, it's probably best to contact your local GP centre to see if they are offering spirometry. Otherwise, you may have to get your GP to refer you to a specialist centre where they can perform it. Respiratory function testing doesn't necessarily diagnose a condition. It helps with the diagnosis, but it takes in a lot of other factors involved in it's involving your signs and your symptoms, your medical history, and they all sort of point together with alongside the respiratory function test to help the doctor decide what condition or diagnose you with the condition. Lung function itself may not directly diagnose, but it assists with it. Now, by performing spirometry, gas diffusion, some lung volume measurements, that can assist in identifying whether or not you may have an obstructive lung disease, similar to COPD or asthma or bronchiectasis, or you have a restrictive lung disease, which is more of the interstitial lung disease, like asbestosis, pulmonary fibrosis. And then you can occasionally get a bit of a mixed pattern as well. So that's which is a combination of, say, asthma and pulmonary fibrosis. So there can be a bit of a combination at times, but it's dead. Respiratory function doesn't diagnose, it just assists with it. With a peak flow meter, you're measuring essentially what it sounds. So you're just measuring the peak speed, peak velocity that you can actually exhale, and it's measured during any moment during that test. Now, it generally happens instantaneously, but it provides you with very little more data after that. It can be quite useful for individuals with asthma, as a peak flow meter can often identify if you're having an exacerbation of your asthma diagnosis. However, that's sort of its limitation. Spirometry, on the other hand, provides a lot more information. It provides how much air you can breathe in and blow out. It measures how much air you can blow out in that first second, which is very important. And it also does measure peak speed as well. So that peak flow will get measured during spirometry as well. So it gives you further information that a peak flow does not. So with a peak flow meter, you don't get the same information. So it doesn't, you won't be able to diagnose or assist with the diagnosis of, say, COPD with a peak flow, because it doesn't provide enough information. So you will have to, if COPD is the, if that's what the GP is potentially looking at or potentially believes you may have, a peak flow won't answer that, spirometry would. Bronchoprovocational testing is a test where we give a patient a inhaled substance, and we are trying to cause a reaction in the airways similar to that of an asthma attack. So what will happen is you get increasing doses from a dose that is of nothing at all compared to just accumulates up and up. And what we're looking at to see is, do you get a change in your forced exhale volume in that first second, so the FEV1? We are seeing a change in that over the increasing doses that we give you. Now, the reason you would be referred for a bronchoprovocation test is if the doctor believes that you may have asthma, that's primarily the main reason, and you've had other investigations and they haven't found a diagnosis, for example. So they would recommend you that you go for a bronchoprovocation challenge, see if you, after with increasing doses, do you get a response? And if you do get a response, then that's indicative of an asthma diagnosis. However, if you get all the way through the course of the inhaled substances and you don't have a response. Doesn't necessarily mean you don't have asthma, but it's just leaning towards that it may not be. So if a patient that's feeling apprehensive before the bronchoprovocation test, I inform them that what we're doing is performed in a safe environment. So we're testing them in a hospital, for example, where I work. However, if it may be performed at a respiratory clinic, which that's the case, they've got trained professionals there to assist. But what with the test, you're inhaling the substance only very small doses. And if you do start to get a reaction to the substance and you get to a certain point, which is 15% of your initial FEV1, so that forced exhale volume, if you drop 15% below that, then that's where we would stop the test. So we're not pushing you all the way to where it's getting to unsafe levels. We are very cautious in what we're doing. So we just, when we start to see signs that you're starting to, your airways are potentially getting a little bit tighter, then once we've hit that 15% off your baseline level, then we stop the test, provide you with a bronchodilator, which can be Ventolin or Asmol, and then we measure to make sure you return back to your normal levels. FeNO is fractional exhaled nitric oxide, and that is a test which assesses the airway inflammation of the lungs. So what happens is that your lungs, dependent, for example, if you have asthma, your airways may produce a certain chemical marker, and that releases nitric oxide. And what will happen is when you go in for this particular test, what we'll get you to do is we get you to blow out for about 8 to 10 seconds at a more of a medium speed. And what we're doing is what the machine's doing is measuring that inflammation on you when you blow out. Now, most of the time, this is performed on individuals that have asthma or in some cases COPD. And it is a test that's getting more widely used on different populations. But it's looking at how responsive your airways could be to certain types of medication. So if you have an elevated FeNO score, you may be more suited for a certain type of inhaler. And that's sort of how the physicians work that in to their treatment plan. DLCO, otherwise known as a gas diffusion test, looks at how well the lungs actually absorb oxygen. Now, it's done primarily at a respiratory clinic or at a hospital, and what it does is you're performing a test similar to spirometry, but involves you holding your breath for around 8 to 10 seconds before blowing back out again. Now, during that breath hold time, you're inhaling a test gas, which is primarily room air, so it's nitrogen and oxygen. But then we've got two tracer chemicals in there. One is carbon monoxide, and the other one is primarily methane. Now, we're using the carbon monoxide to actually measure how well that is absorbed into the body. Now, the methane itself doesn't get absorbed in the body, so we use that for a different purpose, but the actual carbon monoxide absorbs quicker than oxygen. You're only dealing with very small, very minor elements, so it's about 0.3%, so it's very low, and we have a rest period in between. But when you take that deep breath and you're holding your breath for 8 seconds before blowing out, it's giving your body a chance to actually absorb that carbon monoxide, and when you blow back out, we can actually measure what's happened there. Now, with that test, it assists with the diagnosis, for example, of COPD. If you've got some pulmonary fibrosis, it measures, it assists with that. And what it will do is assess how well, sort of assess the severity of how, if there's any impairment in the actual diffusion of the gas. And what it does is when you take that deep breath in, hold for 8 seconds, and you blow back out, we can then measure what kind of, is it, for example, is it within our normal ranges or is it a little bit less than that? And if it's less than that, then it sort of points the physician down a direction of, okay, maybe there's a little bit of a, it could be explaining why you're short of breath or if it's looking more of a general tracking over time. So that's how the gas diffusion test works. lung volume measurements via body plethysmography is involving patients sitting in a booth. Now, it's similar to one of those old school telephone boxes where you do get, the door gets closed, you're sitting and you're breathing through the spirometer. And what it's going to get you to do is you're actually going to try and measure the overall lung size from that test. Now, the door gets closed primarily because we know of its volume, and also we have to try and create a little bit of a pressure change to develop or to try and understand the difference or the size of your lungs during the test. If, for example, during the test we perform it, we can identify if your lungs are a little bit larger than what we would expect, or they might be a little bit smaller than what we expect, or even they are what we expect. But through the test, we can identify, is there any abnormalities regarding the actual overall lung size of the patient? We generally get you to perform a handful of panting maneuvers. Now, that is where you would do some very shallow, like a suck and blow or push-pull against a shutter for a few seconds. And then we would get you to take a really long blow out, followed by a deep breath in, and a long blow back out again. Obviously, this test can be a little bit confronting because you are inside a closed booth, but you can let yourself out quite easily. And the respiratory scientist or the allied health professional taking you through that test, they will be able to assist you with that if you're having any difficulties. Okay, so if you've had a respiratory function test and you're uncertain of what's happened, or you want to know more information about it, it's best just to ask when you go to see your GP or your respiratory physician or whoever's actually referred you for the test, how you actually did on the test. They may say that you've got, for example, your airways are obstructed. But that just could mean that but to what effect does that actually mean to you? So if that's the case, often it's easier just to ask your GP or your referring practitioner about the outcome of the tests, and they will be able to explain it to you.